Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our lesson from the book of Acts, chapter 17, holds a special place in my heart, because I have stood on that site, the Areopagus in Athens. In fact, it's the only biblical place that I've actually been to in my travels and years overseas. It was Christmas Day, 2009. The temperature in Athens, Greece, was a gorgeous 80 to 85 degrees. That's the Mediterranean climate on Christmas Day. Being Christmas Day, none of the museums or tourist attractions would be open for business. So I meandered through the city and went to what I can only describe as open-air archaeology. No fences, no gates, no ticket counters or cashiers. My fifth and sixth graders at CLS have seen the pictures from that tour. And when our Acts Bible study gets to that chapter where we are waiting with Paul for Silas and Timothy to arrive, you'll see them there too. I wandered through the same marketplace that Paul did, the Agora, now only ruins, with stray dogs running loose. The small temples and shrines to a host of false deities are gone. Replaced, though, in other parts of the modern city by shrines to greed, coveting, and consumerism. Buying souvenirs, designer clothes, and a variety of Greek alcohols. The pathway through this agora, this marketplace, heads uphill towards the famous site, the Acropolis, a pagan temple on a high plateau overlooking the entire city, gazing down onto yet another false temple, a large temple dedicated to the false god Zeus. Yet off to the side, before the final ascent to the Acropolis, was another little plateau, a hill on a hill, called the Areopagus, or better translated into English, the Hill of Ares. Ares was what the Latin gods called Mars, or the god of war. So truly, this hill is the hill of the god of war. Now, how interesting and how fitting it is when we look at who's on that hill. Who meets on that hill of the god of war in the book of Acts? It's not generals. It's not the joint chiefs. It's not the military strategists. It is the philosophers. It is the debaters. It is the educated intellectuals who wage war over ideas. What is true? What is goodness? What is right and wrong? What is beauty? These and other essential questions are the prizes for which they do intellectual battle with one another. So in our eyes, it is an honor and privilege and quite deserved that a Christian missionary, a brilliant preacher named Paul, is invited to ascend that same hill from the marketplace to the hill of the god of war. That being said, did they invite him because he was a well-educated former Pharisee? No, it seems like they invite him for mere entertainment. Most began by deeming him a babbler, a fool, an unworthy opponent. They invite him only out of curiosity, not sincerity. They say, "May we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting? For you bring some strange things to our ears. We wish to know, therefore, what these things mean." St. Luke will tell us what their actual motivation is, but notice one important thing. They call it a new teaching. That Jesus' death and resurrection would sound new and foreign to their ears. And yet, from the beginning of the book of Acts, we have seen every Christian confessing and preaching that Christ crucified and risen, repentance and forgiveness proclaimed in his name, is nothing new at all. It is as old as creation and the fall into sin, where we find the first promise of a Savior from sin and death. So indeed, those Jews at the synagogues in Athens, where Paul began, nothing new. If the Athenians and philosophers do not know of the Christ who would come to the Jews and invite into his fold all the nations of the world, then that is an indictment on the Jews there in that city for not spreading the word of the Lord through Moses and the prophets. Now, Luke does reveal what their motivation is in inviting Paul to the Areopagus. They are not inquiring out of a deep desire, this need for salvation. They are not asking for good news, having spent their lives reflecting on their own depravity. They are not asking for light as they sit in darkness. Luke says that these people spend all their time discussing novelties. That's what they found entertaining. They wanted to tickle their fancies. They wanted to enjoy hearing something new, something they'd never heard before. That's the definition of novel. So they look for something foreign and exotic. Once they hear that new teaching, though, it won't be new anymore. They'll wait for another new teaching to come along. So Paul has his work cut out for him. And he begins with a brilliant address that now today is printed on a gigantic plaque at the archaeological site that I visited. This speech in Acts 17 has been studied by Christian apologists and theologians, speechwriters, and even college communication courses will look at it as an example of effectively engaging a strange audience. We might address those aspects in Bible study, but here, with our time so short, let's focus on the law and gospel that Paul preaches. He condemns their ignorance, point blank. Even how remarkable and admitted their ignorance is, that they have an altar to a God that they call unknown, that we don't know who you are, God. Now, he rejects and condemns this idolatry as irrational, unreasonable. Even by their own poets and philosophers' standards, it doesn't hold up. He does not appeal to the Old Testament as he does when preaching to Christians or witnessing to Jews. He appeals to natural knowledge, to logic, to human reason, and he calls them to repent. He says, if man is the child of God, or as in the biblical terms, made in the image of God, then why are you foolish Athenians worshiping gold and stone and wood? If man is made in the image of God, then why are you becoming obedient to things that are subhuman? Now, we know that it is the very nature of idolatry to drag us humans down far beneath what God created man to be. That is the crown of his creation. God gave mankind dominion over the earth. But after the fall into sin, we sinful human beings worship the creation that we were to have dominion over. We worship the creation instead of the Creator. We serve and obey and slave over things that are beneath us. And in that sinful inversion, we try to exert our lowly authority over the God who is actually above us. And do not think that this is just the pitfall of ignorant ancient Athenians. Ignorance of the true triune God has grown exponentially in our day and age, even within the church. A damnable biblical illiteracy has infected many corners of the church throughout the world, and especially in our nation. And what does that show, or what does that prove, other than we have a lack of concern and affection for God, a lack of reverence for him who in his grace spoke to us and revealed his will to us in Holy Scripture. In him we live and move and have our being, and woe to us if we do not know who he is. Once again, do not think that we are so much better than the ancient peoples. They had giant temples dedicated to the sacrificing of pigs to Zeus. We have stadiums that seat 10 times that many people, religiously devoted to praising and worshiping 22 grown men fighting over a dead pigskin. They had temples in all devoted to the sacrifice of bulls and goats, to all manner of deities carved out of wood or stone. We have ballparks focused on leather balls, wooden bats, and the curse of the billy goat. We have grand facilities all across our nation, dedicated to spending all our money on something new, hearing something new, watching something new, buying something new, wearing something new. So, oh dear Christians, pity those ancient, ignorant Athenians, if you will, but first, examine yourselves. Where you find yourself elevating aspects of the creation above the Creator to the heights of idolatry and praise, repent and turn away from those things. When you see yourselves denying God or relegating the true God to being a minor, unimportant, or expendable afterthought in your weekly life, repent and beg His mercy and forgiveness. As Paul teaches, before the time of Jesus' incarnation, God endured and overlooked the ignorance. He still punished the wickedness of sin. He still sent His word to the people of Israel to be a light to the Gentiles and pagans. But Paul says, now the time of ignorance is over. The time of not knowing God rightly has passed away. The unbelievers will not escape judgment for wickedly, ignorantly denying the true God. How much more will God hold accountable those who have the testimony among them, yet spurn it, reject it, and treat it as nothing? Treat it as worth only an hour and not 65 minutes. Meanwhile, those dead pigskins get 3 hours. Paul declares with a word that ought to shake all of Athens and all of our hearts to the core. The times of ignorance God overlooked, but now He commands all people everywhere to repent. Turn from evil. Reject and remove the idols from your heart and life. Why? Paul says, because God has fixed a day on which He will judge the world in righteousness by a man whom He has appointed. And there He gives them the gospel. And of this He has given us assurance to all by raising Him from the dead. Paul, the preacher of foreign divinities, as they call it, was invited to the hill of the God of war as mere entertainment because Jesus' name was new to their ears. His death, His resurrection seemed to them a novelty, a new teaching, something innocent and harmless, a foreign novelty that they would hear and file away for a footnote in an academic paper sometime. Much to their surprise, then, Paul calls them into the presence of the living God, and he calls them to repent. Repent of their ignorance of the true God. He calls them and you to repent, and to repent sincerely. Because God has chosen a day that is known only to Him. No debate on Mars Hill can ascertain what day that day of judgment will be. But on that day, we will be judged. God will judge the world in righteousness by the one whom He has appointed, the Lord Jesus Christ. None will be declared righteous on account of works, for all have sinned. None will be declared righteous on account of ignorance, because ignorance is not an excuse. The only ones who will be declared righteous in that judgment are those who trust in the salvation of that name, the name of Jesus, who once was dead but was raised by God as a confirmation, as to give us assurance of God's grace towards mankind, a grace finally and forever demonstrated in the justification of the sinner before God on Judgment Day. Now, woe to the preacher who would forget or omit this truth, too. None will be declared righteous whose faith is dead and produces nothing but a return to ignorance and idolatry. Look again at 1 Peter chapter 3 throughout this week, even the verses that come before our lesson. They are an excellent example of how one who has been washed and saved in baptism, redeemed by the blood of Christ, how he lives in faith toward his neighbor. Faith receives receives the gifts of salvation from God and then is directed outward in love and affection toward his neighbor. In the verses right before our lesson begins, Peter teaches that brothers in Christ will live in faith by having unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind. Do not repay evil for evil or reviling for reviling, but on the contrary, bless. For to this you were called, that you may obtain a blessing. This is nothing more and nothing less than what Jesus taught in our gospel lesson of love for the Son, love for the Father, love for the Holy Spirit, the life of faith lived in God and among the neighbors. So once more, as Paul called upon the Athenians, we call upon one another. Repent without delay. As abruptly as Jesus ascended into heaven, so also he will abruptly return for that judgment. A judgment of righteousness on account of faith in his saving work. A faith that is not dead, but alive to God in Jesus Christ. As Jesus said, because I live, you also will live. And we know that ignorance and idolatry is no life at all. It is death and darkness and far beneath the image of God. So as new men, raised up in baptism, justified in the blood of Christ, sanctified by the Holy Spirit, let us put off the old